Hello.
Good evening, friends. I must firstly compliment an excellent seminar that is taking place. Wonderful sessions. Am I audible now? Yeah, is that fine? Great, great. So friends, I'm going to share with you a small presentation. I'm an architect, so I'm going to voice an architect's thoughts towards the urban planning. And there are certain thoughts that you will definitely agree with me that which leaves us with questions. And these are very important questions that we must address. And I'm very happy to see stalwarts, you know, who are responsible for our city, our country's future in terms of the future development. So the topic is sustainability in urban design. So basically, when we talk about architecture, simply to describe this in three words, we call it as a space, people, and happiness. So it's all about the space that we plan. It's for the people, most important. Every built environment has to be people-centric. It has to produce the happiness. What is the current scenario? All of us, we know. The two-thirds of the world population will live in cities. You can see the graph how it's going to go up in 2030 and 2050. You can see our country in the global scenario. You know, the chart here clearly explains that's our country where I've made a circle. You can see all the oranges and all the yellows, which clearly says that we'll have a large size cities, mega cities, we'll have a medium cities, we'll also have a small cities. So all of us, we know that's also our government agenda, that there will be a lot of rapid urbanization that is going to take place. So India has been urbanizing rapidly in recent decades. Estimated that the urban population will reach almost 590 million by 2030. It's almost double than what we have it today in 2017. This is a need. This is an interesting chart which tells us that today from 9, we'll have a 13 megacities. And out of those 13 megacities, 6 cities will have a population which will be more than 10 million people. Second line says that 33 to 55, we'll have 55 cities which will be in the tier 2, which will have a population of 1 to 4 million. Just to give you a comparison with the United States, which is one of the biggest country, has currently a 9 cities in that particular category. So this is just to explain you the magnitude in which we are going to grow in terms of our built environment. What are the concerns? The biggest concern that we have today is pollution. And that pollution, which is largely creating through various different aspects, one of the most important aspects is the cars. You know, you'll see today everywhere there is a parking lots. Like an Indian architect, whenever I talk with my international friends, the parking ratio here is absolutely enormous. So if you'll see, that is creating a lot of fuel emission, that is also creating a lot of traffic congestion, no matter it is Delhi, it is Mumbai, or it is Bangalore or any megapolis city. What is it that is trying to tell us for these cities' growth? When we talk about this, we can see that these cities are going to grow by 2030. There will be more than 3 times, 4 times. You will see the electricity scenario, 1.4 billion people, no access to electricity. India accounts almost 300 million people. Water is another issue where only 74% of the urban households have a pipe water. That is also not for 24 hours. It is only for 4 to 5 hours a day. The infrastructure will have a huge amount of investment that is going to take place in near future. And India currently is number 3 in terms of creating the population after China and USA. So these are the numbers which definitely all of you know, but the magnitude is really, really very scary. So what does it mean? That all of us, we have a responsibility when we do a new projects. How do we concentrate on programming? See, this is one interesting thing which I want to tell you. Today in Mumbai, everybody has minimum 1 car, and a middle income people have 2 cars, and the luxury people have more than 4 to 8 cars. Each car takes 400 square foot for a car parking. And as per the rule, what are we doing? For every 1,000 square foot of a house, we are building another 1,000 square foot of a parking. So for every 1 million square foot, we are building another 0.8 million square foot of a parking. And these parkings are in the basements, podiums, huge, huge amount of concrete, huge amount of a structure. Today, people are finding it good, but after 10, 15 years, all of these basements, all of these podiums are going to become one of the biggest worry for all of us because they require forced ventilation, they require various kinds of mechanical devices. So is it the right direction in which we are going? Fortunately, in 2034 DC regulation, the parking has come down to half. Today, people are not selling the car because car does not give them a better value, and people start parking the car on the road because they do not have parking facility in their societies. That is creating a congestion for the road. It's one of the biggest issues. What is an inspiration? You know, the inspiration, this is a shard. This is a building in London, Canary Wharf, where this building is 1.2 million square foot of office premises, where every day 10,000 people come. Do you know how much car parking this building has? You will be surprised to know this building has only 48 car parking. Only 48 car parking for 1.2 million square foot of office premises, where every day 10,000 people come and go. A similar building, if I have to design here, we have to provide not less than 3,000 car parking. So that 3,000 car parking into 400 square foot, which is another 1.2 million square foot, so much of an investment, so much of a maintenance for the people who are there. How could they do it and why can't we do it? You'll see another example of a Hong Kong where 90% of the people, they commute to their office through a public transport. It is a story everywhere in the world. You'll go to New York, you'll go to Toronto. Nowhere people provide the parking like the crazy way we people are providing a parking. We are not realizing what problems we are creating for our future. This city has 90% of the people who go with the public transport. Every building is looking so beautiful because there is no that huge giant parking lot below. You'll see all the architecture here is surrounded with first 8 to 10 level of a parking lot and then the building springs up. So when are we going to think about this? It's us who have to decide as to how do we cut down on this absolutely unwanted concrete and embodied energies and everything. You know, it's a quest for the developers. There are a lot of stalwart developers who are here, and it is quite doable. You'll see another example of Singapore. You know, Singapore faced this problem 15 years back. What we are facing today, they faced it 15 years back. So they made a rule. There cannot be more car parking than 1:10 families. There will be a public car parking where there is a diversity factor. In fact, they don't allow you to buy a car unless you have a legal car parking slot. So people cannot buy a car there unless they show to the registration department that I have a legal proper car parking slot. And these are the people who started using carpooling almost 10 years back. Today you will see in all of our offices, people come alone in the car, they go alone in the car. Why can't we do carpooling? Why can't we use public transportations, which is now available? This is where we need to look into. You know, this is one of the very, very major issue. I feel small is beautiful, less is more. And this is something that we are doing more is definitely going to hit us very badly. So optimization in the construction is one of the aspects. I spoke about the parking. Another issue that all our greenery is going away. All the trees are getting cut. We want a urbanization, so land parcels are going to become small. It's quite obvious that those trees will have to be retransplanted and things like that. Again, in Singapore, there is an interesting rule. If your plot is of 1 lakh square foot and you are going to build a building on that plot, you have to do a 1 lakh square foot of a garden, because you are taking away that 1 lakh square foot of the garden from the city. So they count the garden which is also on the vertical surfaces, also on the horizontal surfaces of the terraces. So at the end of the day, please understand the opportunity of creating a garden is not only on the floor. You can have a vertical vegetation, you can have a rooftops, you can have a terraces. It's a myth that these kind of things are tedious to maintain, they will create a waterproofing problem. No. This science has reached to a stage where we can have a beautiful biofiltering techniques, you can have a beautiful vertical vegetation. People love plants, you know, people do it. And this is where it has to come from everyone, you know, from an architect, from a developer, from civil engineers, from an end consumer point of view. This is happening in our neighboring countries where the similar kind of a tropical environment is there. So this is something where also I think we should play a little innovative, increase our green footprint, it can do all the things. Water. Now, I was there for one conference and one of my Singapore friend architects said that we waste only 2% water. I said, how is that possible? 98% water, what happens? So, to tell all of you, in Singapore, it is legal to recycle the grey water. And that grey water which is recycled, people use it for bathing and people use it for drinking. Whenever you go to Singapore and you pick up a bottle of Neo water on the airport, it's a grey water, recycled water. But it goes through such a wonderful process that it is perfectly safe, perfectly hygienic for the purpose of the wholesome water requirement that we have. So there, again, they are 10 years ahead of us where all the water is properly recycled. You know, and there are a lot of people who are also doing it here, and I'm very happy and proud to see that the good corporate organizations are water positive today. You know, they are not only consuming less water, but they are giving the recycled water to the neighboring communities. That's something which is quite innovative. So that's about the water. All ways of transportation. I mean, we have to build this attitude in our next generation. And I'm happy it's already getting built. A lot of people today on a weekend do not take out their car. They go with Uber, they go with Ola, they go with this other transport mediums, which is definitely good because there is a diversity factor there. So encourage the use of public transport. So can our buildings, instead of being consumers' energy, transform into a producers of the energy? Can buildings, instead of depleting the green and add to the green footprint? I'll share some examples with you where the large, high-density, high-rise buildings, they are not consuming, they are generating. You know, so solutions. You can see that there are smart cities which are required. There's an intelligent transport system that is required. Renewable energy is one of the very strong tools where we can do a lot of things and save our energy. Sustainable water solutions and, of course, waste management. Because waste is also one of the very, very scaring aspects that we are going to deal with. I really feel there is a good case study. We have it in Mumbai, which is a Hiranandani Park, you know. It's one of the great township where everything is compact. It's a mixed-use development. Everything is pedestrianized. So if you'll see the happiness quotient of the people who are occupying there, they're very happy. Because once they go back to their home, there's really a good lifestyle, which is pedestrianized lifestyle, you know. They don't have to take out their vehicle to go for their basic needs. Everything is almost on the walkable distance. And there are many other. I just took one of the examples. There are many other such sustainable townships are coming. But we need to ensure that the compact mixed-use development, a transit-oriented destination, is the future for us. These are various mediums of the transportation we already have. We must encourage that we use them so that we minimize our fuel emission. Carpooling is one of the best ideas. The battery-operated electrical cars is a good idea. Bicycling, you know, bicycling is catching up very well in all the countries. We should also ensure that whenever there is a lesser distance, we should use the bicycle and the pedestrianization. So today you'll see the 45% of the people, they go by car to any place they want to go. We need to aim to reduce it to 10%, whereby people should use the other medium of commuting. Common factor, the diversity factor, it will definitely help us. These are the various opportunities for the renewable energy, solar, wind, biomass, hydrogen, geothermal, ocean. Again, this science is developing very rapidly in our country. We must make a good use of it. This is the one building which I love it. This is a building next to a Pearl River. It is designed by a famous architectural firm called SOM. This is a tall building. It's a 385-meter tall building. And here you can see how an architect and engineer, they can come together and create a marvel. What is available for such tall building? A wind. Wind is freely available for such tall building. So they have very nicely developed a form of the building which is such that the wind which comes and hits the building goes with the aerodynamic shape of the facade, goes to its mechanical floor where they have the wind turbines. So all that wind which hits the building facade automatically goes to the service floors which are at the intermediate levels, and there you have a nice wind turbines and it generates the energy. And that energy has been used for the building's common areas. So nice use of the constraints converting into an opportunity. It's an award-winning building. When they actually produced these papers, before this building started, many people thought it will be only theoretic. How can it work? But it's working. It's working very well there for last almost 6-7 years, and they are generating a lot of power through the wind, through the architectural justice. This also shows you the solar radiation form as to how cool areas they could create in the whole building. One of the best examples, that's the building which is standing tall there next to Pearl River. This is in Gonzao. Masdar City is another beautiful example, which is in Abu Dhabi. Abu Dhabi is not known for any habitable development. It's got a very extreme summer. The temperature goes up to 50 degrees. But again, here the constraints have been developed into opportunity, and they have come up with the first phase, which is 6 square kilometers, where almost 2 to 3 million square foot of work is completed and people are occupying those places. It's completely on a solar farms. They have used best way of the solar farms. The building shapes are such, it's a compact city. The whole roof comes out in such a way that it gives a shading to the whole building. It allows to have the vegetation within the intermediate floors, and it generates the energy for the entire building. This is a net zero building, having a 6 million square foot of an area. 60 lakh square foot of an area will not depend on any power to come from the grid. It will be all self-generated power. And you can see there in the right-hand side diagram, all the red that shows that's the ambient temperature in Abu Dhabi, and all the blue, that will be the temperature in the building. So how you can create a beautiful architecture, how you can create a beautiful people-centric environment through a simple techniques. And these techniques are very, very easily available. They are robust, they are tested, they are working fine. So these are the things. Again, a beautiful idea where there is a, these are the towers which has a mist jets because there's a lot of hot, dry weather. So the air goes through these mist fans, there's a evaporative cooling, and you get at least 5 to 6 degrees lesser temperature with a soft mist coming on you. It gives you a little bit of a better way to have a evaporative cooling. So these are all the measures are practically there. These are not theoretical. It's already functioning there very well. You can see inside the courtyard almost there is a 6 to 8 degree difference because of these particular strategies. Some of the sketches which shows as to how this can do. Also in the public areas, they have used this kind of umbrellas, which are actually a solar generating umbrellas. They are there in the daytime. They generate all the energy, and in the night time, they close. So it gives you a beautiful nighttime view of the sky. So these are all experimental things have now come into a real-time story, and I think it's something that we also should exploit in our country and must use all of these measures. These are the pictures. Those are the solar farming, daylight harvesting. So they are bringing outside daylight, going into an every area of the basement. So even the basements has the daylight tubes, and the daylight transfers through these strategies to every square foot which is there in that building. Some of the pictures. That's a net zero building. So when we talk about water, again, we talked about Singapore, where we have rainwater harvesting as an opportunity. We also have the gray water management. You know, so these strategies have proved that you can save almost 40% of the water without having any major investments. You talk about the waste management. A lot of waste gets generated when it's a high density development. How many of you know that 20,000 square foot of a land parcel can generate 1 megawatt energy with the investment of 1.5 to 2 crore rupees? There are so many complexes where we have thousands of families living. If we give just a 20,000 square foot of a land, we can create a very sustainable 1 megawatt power energy biogas project over there, which is going to be absolutely free once the project is installed. So these are the things that we can create out of waste, which is normally a constraint, but there is an opportunity to generate power out of it. So a lot of people have the craving for a zero discharge. What does zero discharge means? There will be nothing that will go outside the compound as an effluent. No water will get discharged to stormwater drain. Today we see tsunamis and tornadoes and the flooding because a lot of water, a lot of dirt, a lot of plastic that gets into the public drainage system, and it chokes up the flow of the water to go to ocean. But here is an opportunity where you can have a zero discharge. It has been proved that all the water that is generated, recycled, is used within the compound. ITC is one of the great example. They have taken an oath to create every square foot of their hospitality as a LEED Platinum. They are doing a fantastic job. They are saving almost 28 to 30% on each of their hotel premises. They are all water positive. In a hotel, there is a guest which comes 24/7. So all that gray water that is getting generated in these hotels, it is recycled. 90% of the recycled water is used for the air conditioning makeup water tank, and remaining is being given to the neighboring community. So there is a good social corporate responsibility they are doing. And I think that is an opportunity for every particular developer who is into a high density thing. These kind of things can give you the energy saving up to 20-30% easily. It can give you 40-60% water saving easily without spending any extra money. And if you do an exemplary performance, you can have a net zero energy positive buildings, which are already coming up in various parts of the globe. I think it's a high time now. We should adopt these strategies with us. So IGBC is the Indian Green Building Council. I'm here as an executive committee member besides an architect. This is a completely a non-profit making NGO organization where our craving is to spread the awareness about the green strategy. You can imagine there was only one building of 20,000 square foot in 2001. Today we have 4.66 billion square foot of a footprint, which includes all kind of project, residential, hotel, commercial, hospital, industries, airports, everything. Every sector has been covered under this. This chart also explains you as to how various senior dignitaries who have come into picture to do this kind of an exercise. And all of this chart actually explains how it is growing. We have almost 4,205 projects coming up there, explains about the energy efficiency, some of the exemplary performances done where LEED Platinum things have already come into a picture. You can see how the difference between the green building and other building, it looks same from outside, but the performance of these buildings is much better. Again, some of the exemplary performance, this is ITC Royal at Bangalore. It again gives you how much reduction you can do, you know, and it actually gives you a payback. It's not only something that you want to put it only on your collar as a 5-star or a LEED Platinum, but actually gives you the tangible benefits. This is a TCS Technopark at Chennai. Some of the interior projects also where you can use the zero VOC, a good indoor environmental quality. And this is an interesting chart where you could see a few years back when you used to do a green building, it used to cost you 18% more cost. Today, it is only 2% more cost. So only 2% more cost, but huge tangible benefits. And I think that is what is going to go into every sector, commercial, healthcare, industrial, built environment. Also, the government has started giving the incentive for the green buildings in terms of more FSI. The banks have started giving the finances at the subsidized rate. So it's been catching up. There's a Congress which is in Jaipur from 5th to 7th October. I surely urge many of you to you can come there. A lot of good things are going to happen. Plenty of national and international speakers and eminent panelists will be talking on 3 days for innovative approach for the sustainable future. So everything that we do has to have a sustainability in mind. And the best way to predict the future is to design it. That's said by the famous architect Buckminster Fuller. With this, I say thank you to all of you.
Well, thank you very much, sir. If I may please request you to remain on the stage. And may I please invite Mr. Vijay Manohot to please come on the stage to also present the token of gratitude to architect Sandeep Shikre.